HarperCollins presents The House on Rye Lane by Susan Allott. Read by Coral Sinclair, Tim Bruce, Tom Babbage. For Sam and Lauren. 1. The 14th of December, 1994. It was the day of the murder, a dark Wednesday in South London, and Diana was listening to the lodgers. They were on the staircase, all three of them. She couldn't see them from the ground floor, but she heard them clearly. She felt their shock. Lee Delaney was shouting orders at his wife and child. There was fear in his voice, in the quiet of the house. One of them whimpered and puked on the carpet. "Do you hear me?" Lee said. Ruth and Cookie replied that they did. He ran up to the next floor, told them not to move. Diana listened. She located the mother and son from their voices. They were together on the stairs, halfway up. Out on the street, she heard rain bouncing off the tarmac, a car horn on the far side of the Rye. A door slammed at the top of the house. Cookie spoke, frightened words that Diana didn't catch. But she knew his voice with its adolescent tremor. She pictured him, stooped and awkward in his school uniform, all at odds with himself. That strange boy. "Let me think," Ruth said to her son. "Be quiet a minute." Diana wished she had never let them into her house, this family with all their problems. But you couldn't pick and choose lodgers in this part of town, and the house put most normal people off. She had lived here all her life, as had all the Lloyds before her, not because it was a beloved family home, but because no one had ever managed to sell it. It had been grand once, apparently. But nothing had ever gone right in the house on Rye Lane. It was a house of mistakes, of luck turned bad, of love gone cold. Most people knew that before they got through the door. Ruth stepped down into the hallway. Diana heard her shoes on the tiles, the skim of her shower-proof coat. Ruth despised her. Diana had cottoned on to this too late. She'd thought Ruth was reserved, a bit surly. But it ran deeper than that, and stronger, more poisonous for being suppressed. It had scared her when it rose to the surface. "Don't look down," Ruth said to Cookie as he followed her. But Cookie looked. His face was the last face Diana would see, his pale fright at the sight of her. She caught the smell of vomit on his socks. Her left foot dropped from the bottom stair as he stepped over her, and her head rocked back. She saw a different patch of ceiling then, before her vision darkened. Ruth Delaney stifled a scream. Diana was not scared now. It was too late for that. But she was angry at this old lady's death she'd been given, a bag of old bones at the foot of the stairs. She knew that when she was found there would be sympathy, and she would not be able to refuse it. There would be questions, but she would not get to ask them. This was the thing that really got her. She would die without answers, without knowing which of the Delaneys had given her that shove, whose hands she had felt at her back. She died in the minutes before the ambulance arrived, before the house was searched and the Delaneys were pushed into police cars. She heard the rain and the shouting, then only rain. She thought that the house might rest now, with the last of the Lloyds gone. She thought, surely now there can be happiness here. People will bring love inside and it will live. The house heard this last thought of hers, swallowed it into its history, and buried it. 2. The 12th of September, 2008. Maxine pushed open the gate and led the way up the steps to the front door. Seb was slow to follow. He was on the phone, telling someone he would call them back. She felt his reluctance, the bad mood that fell over him whenever they came to the house. The renovations bored and frustrated him, whereas she would happily spend the day watching it all happen, planning colour schemes and room layouts, discussing where they might move a door or a light fitting. She thought about it constantly when she couldn't be here. From the first viewing, she had loved this place. and if you'd asked her why, she would have said it had bags of potential, with its original Georgian fixtures and fittings, its aspect looking out across the Rye at the morning sun, its location at the good end of Peckham, which was on the up. She would have said it was cheap, even when you factored in the cost of the work they'd need to do, which was considerable. It was a project, but she loved a project. She had the optimism of a woman who badly wanted everything to be fine. A breeze blew in across the common, shaking conkers out of the trees. Maxine opened the door. "Can we be quick here, Max?" Seb stood on the threshold, tall and sharp in his suit. "I don't fancy the full tow." She put the keys in her pocket and held the door open with her foot. "I just need a quick word with Alexander. I missed a call from him earlier."
"His van's not here."
Seb turned and pointed out at the street, the space next to the skip where the van would normally be. "He'll have knocked off early. It's Friday." She pushed the door shut behind Seb and stood at the foot of the stairs, breathing disturbed air, brick dust and plaster. Dust sheets were spread out over the tiled floor, covered in boot prints. She called out hello, but she could tell by the quiet that the builders had left. There was a huge saw leaning against the wall and a crowbar blocking the steps down to the kitchen, a black bucket on its side. It looked like they might have downed tools and left in a hurry. "I hope there wasn't a problem," she said. He stood beside her and looked up the stairs.
"Looks like it's still standing, which is all I need to know."
"Did you hear from Alexander today?"
"Possibly. My phone hasn't stopped."
He smiled weakly, pushing his glasses up his nose.
"Listen, Max, I was going to wait until we got home."
She heard something in his tone, something new. She turned to him and held him by the sleeve.
"Things aren't good at work," he said.
"What do you mean?"
"I think you were right. The rumour you heard about Barclays."
She stared at him. A lorry passed the house, shaking the ground floor windows.
"I mean, it's just a rumour," he said.
"But people are saying Barclays have pulled the plug."
Maxine looked down at her feet, because she didn't want to hear this, or to see Seb looking at her with that expression on his face. She wanted to walk through the rooms measuring progress, checking jobs off her list.
"Let's not worry about it now," she said. "My source wasn't sure it was true. I probably shouldn't have mentioned it."
Jason's rattled.
"Doesn't mean we need to worry."
"No, but Jason thinks..." "I don't care what Jason thinks."
She ran her hand down the smooth oak of the banister and felt the height and depth of the building, the weight of the abandoned rooms above her.
"You'd get another job," she said, "if the bank went under. You'd be all right." "I'm pretty tied to layman's, money-wise."
She nodded, taking this in. She wished he didn't look so scared.
"How much of your money's tied to layman's?"
"All of it," he said.
"I didn't know that. None of it's vested yet."
"What does that mean?"
"It means I can't sell the stock. There's nothing I can do, Maxine."
She tried to think of something to say that wasn't what she was thinking. "It won't happen," was the best she could do. "There'll be some kind of deal." He dropped his head, took off his glasses. She thought for a second he might be about to cry. In the year they'd been together, she had never seen him cry. He was a few years younger than she was, and he had told her on their third date that he didn't want anything serious. He'd tried to break it off when she'd said she was getting to the age, nearly 30, where she couldn't really mess around. But he'd called her a week later and asked if he could take her biological clock to the cinema. They'd met up for drinks first, got talking and missed the film. They'd spent every weekend together after that, and he'd told her that he'd known from the first date he was going to fall in love with her. He was scared, he'd said, but he couldn't stay away.
"We'll be all right," she said.
He wasn't crying, but she ran her thumb sideways across his face as he stood beside her at the foot of the stairs. He wasn't vain enough for contact lenses, and he was blind enough that his glasses were part of his face, his eyes big and blurred without them. He looked familiar but strange, vulnerable.
She tried not to worry. The house was in her name, bought outright with the money her dad had left her. Seb was funding all the work Alexander was doing. This was the deal they had struck. The whole renovation project was dependent on Seb, his inflated banker's salary, his bonus. "Come on," she said, fitting his glasses back onto his face. They went up to the top floor and Seb stood at the garret window looking out across the common. The loft room was dark and cluttered and it smelled bad, like something was off, like the decaying underside of a root vegetable. Maxine kicked gently at an abandoned sleeping bag in the corner of the room and it wheezed spores of mould over her shoe. "What are you looking at?" "That's Canary Wharf through the trees," he said, pointing. "You could see our trading floor with a decent telescope." She stepped around the filthy old sofa, which was probably where the smell was coming from. There was a blanket beside it on the floor, and underneath that she could just see the back pocket of a pair of jeans, one grubby trainer. "Show me," she said, coming to stand beside him. He held her by the shoulders and guided her so she could see it from where she stood. The pyramid roof of Canada Tower with its red light on top and the cluster of skyscrapers around it. "So it is," she said. "Look at that." A plane flew low overhead. The common was an expanse of brown, pocked earth, fringed with rush hour traffic. "It's been common land since forever. Never been built on," she said, nodding out at the boggy grass. "The Rye, they call it, locally. I think it's Old English." She didn't look at him. She knew he loved this kind of thing. He was the only person she'd met who could stand in front of a burial mound on a windy Sunday afternoon in a state of rapture. Stone ruins and monuments blew his mind. Some historians believe Boudicca's last battle was fought on Peckham Rye. He turned to her. "Did you make that up?"
"Why would I do that?"
"To distract me." She smiled, and he pulled her close against him. He was warm, and his shirt smelled of the dry cleaners. She wished she hadn't told him about that rumour at work. "I'm sure this will all blow over," she said.
"I hope you're right."
"I mean, too many people have too much to lose."
"True," he said, looking down at the roof of a bus. "Way too much."
Maxine stayed there with her arms around him, trying not to stress. The money was one thing. The other thing, in some ways more scary, was whether she could keep loving him through this. She didn't want to fall out of love again, her old, bad habit. She had moved down to London from the remote part of Scotland where she grew up because she had needed a fresh start, away from her romantic track record. She had bought a house and found a good man who loved her. She had a career and an expensive trouser suit. She was brand new. The sun came out and the grass brightened. The tree stood out rich green against the traffic.
"Did you see this?"
Seb ran his fingers over a row of small holes in the woodwork of the window, in the horizontal strip where the panes were divided. The paint was peeling away and he scratched at it with his thumb.
"Someone hammered nails into it, tried to keep it shut."
"Do you think?"
"It's old," he said, examining the timber. "Might be the original window."
He pulled his hand back and looked around at the open door leading to the staircase.
"Do you ever find it creepy?
The house, I mean."
She laughed. "It's been empty for years. It just needs a good airing."
"But there's something, isn't there?"
"Can't say I've noticed."
"Maybe it's just me."
His phone beeped in his pocket and he jumped. They both laughed, jittery laughter that sounded too loud, too bright in the dark room. Maxine led the way down the stairs, past the big, sad rooms where she managed not to notice the change in the light, the watchful walls. She locked the front door and they shut the gate behind them, stood together on the street looking up at the house. It was tall and old and dignified, despite the dirty brick and the cracks in the mortar, the heavy growth of ivy and the crumbling steps leading to the front door. The curtains were pulled shut on the second floor, except for an opening at the left-hand window, the one with the crack in the pane.
"Should we mention that window to Alexander?" she asked Seb. But he had turned from her, walking away with his hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.